Okay. Okay. Guten Abend. Bon après-midi. Good afternoon. We're now on the midpoint of the afternoon of talks. We just enjoyed an interesting conversation with Sock Pop, chaired by Patrick Ash, and we're about to experience Ed Key and William Pugh. Ed Key is a game developer from Cumbria, whom I work with. Let me declare my interest. So I might occasionally just be correcting him, going, no, talk about this, because I'm his producer, so I have an interest in him presenting himself well. Yes, Ed Key, famous game developer from Cumbria, who you might know from the game Proteus, and who is currently working on a new procedural storytelling game called Forest of Sleep, which is very good. You should buy that when it comes out. And the estimable William Pugh, whose studio is Crows, 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 and you might know him from such games as The Stanley Parable, which will eventually be on this screen. They're going to chair themselves, and then I'll come back for the Q&A at the end, so enjoy the experience. Give them a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.
The controller's broken. Oh, no, wait, no, it's not. Ugh, wow. So this is Proteus, eh? Ed,
yeah.
Is it? Okay. It's good. Why does it say creating there?
I can't remember. I don't remember that being there.
Do you think that ruins the minimal kind of affect of the game? That's an imperfection. All right, let's tear this apart. So everything's sprites. Did you do like sprite work before this? Like what did your art look like before Proteus?
I think this is probably the first thing I drew.
Really?
Well, I guess I've worked on like little tiny unreleased prototypes. I'm unmuted.
Hey, for the benefit of the recording, I'm now unmuted. I guess
so. This is the first thing that you've made?
Yeah, it's the first thing I released. I worked on a few little unfinished things, like a procedurally generated platformer thing. And then Spelunky came out, so that was kind of no point in doing that because, well, I'm sure no, that's not quite true. But yes, I mean, I guess the whole art style of this is just me working around the fact that I'm not very good at drawing.
Is it MS Paint?
No, it's Paint.net.
Oh.
And Graphic Scale. Ooh. Graphic Scale. Pro Tools.
So the soundscape's based off objects and proximity to objects. So what makes sound? Like, I think this.
Yeah, the flowers and the trees. I mean, what you're hearing now is like the first set of sounds that went into the game. Mm-hmm. So this is when I sent David Kanega a build of the game with no sound, and it looked pretty much like this. I guess like not, you know, some of the colors are different or whatever, but this like spring daytime is the first set of sounds that went in. So you can hear the little like swoopy sine waves, I think, are coming from being in the proximity of trees. The little chimes, I think, are from the flowers, the yellow flowers. It's quite hard to pick out layers.
What's this?
Well, you just have to call it what you like, really.
Oh.
I mean, it's a frog, technically.
It's a frog.
But some people think they're rabbits, but they don't have ears, so it's kind of strange.
Can you catch it? Is there a way to bug it and catch the frog?
You can kind of surf on the fear of bees.
I like how bees are a game mechanic. I hope we get to that.
I think they're not around this season, but yeah, I think if you kind of run downhill away from some bees, you can overtake it, and you can't really catch it. You can just kind of mess with it a bit. But.
So, did you ever think about making it more gamey?
There was one version that had cities in, and I guess the idea we had. So these kind of big, like blocky, abstract kind of monoliths, I'm still waiting for the point where we're going to argue.
When we're going to start. Okay, all right.
No,
okay.
Can we talk about the stakes first? I'll talk about the stakes first. It's constantly in the back of my mind that
I'll find something to pick apart while you're talking about.
Anyway, the cities are these kind of big black, like odd abstract monolith things with some like color coding on them, and it generated paths between them and signposts pointing to the different cities. And the idea was that I think it has like a really simple thing where you just if you, you had a little colored object that popped up in the side of the screen when you went to the city of that color. Oh no, sorry, a city of a different color, and it, like the color of the object was telling you to take it to another city. So it was just like a thing where you were kind of repeatedly joining the dots between the cities. And every time you did that, it added another layer onto a different set of music. So it had this kind of like percussive driving kind of thing that was completely separate to this soundscape. And I guess the idea we had was that it was you could kind of carry on doing that, and we were going to make that sort of more like make that kind of satisfying itself to do. But it was sort of a red herring, and the rest of the stuff that you're supposed to be kind of doing and looking at was was to get away from that and, I don't know, like stare at the sunset off a cliff. But it was too obstructive.
How do you climb?
You're trying to chop the tree down.
No, how do you climb trees?
Yeah, you can't do that.
How do you jump?
It's not a climbing simulator.
How do you jump? Why can't I jump?
You can sit down.
You can't? What, really?
Yeah, I think that's the button you're pressing. Just press it once. There you go.
Oh, shit! Oh, my God! I can't believe you could do that. Oh, does that do anything?
No.
Okay.
No. I mean, it just feels relaxing, but you have to know it's there, and we never really publicized it.
So why didn't you train the player in that?
Like a little press yeah. A to sit.
Yeah.
Prop up. We just got really strict about not putting any text at all or any UI.
Well, you
UI
had creating dot dot dot.
Yeah. And the title of the game.
And the credits.
Yeah, from that point, yeah.
So you had to self-promote there.
Yeah, as you know, compromised our principles.
What are these like? Are these little bits of grass?
Yeah, it's just a little.
Oh, that's cute.
Green nonsense.
What does that mean? What does the grass represent?
The grass represents the nature's bounty.
Okay, then what does the tree represent?
That's
is that also nature's
ambivalence.
I feel like I'm. It's quite relaxing.
Oh, and the frogs sing more in the rain as well. So.
Oh, really? Do different objects behave differently in the rain?
I think it's just the frogs.
Oh.
They make that little bloop, bloop, bloop. When they're still, like when you.
I'm gonna catch this frog. They don't.
It might take a while.
Okay. All right. So what would Proteus 2 look like now? Like if you had to make this game again with this already existing, like what would it look like?
Yeah, I've been thinking about that recently. Just thinking about selling out. We know it's called Proteus. So.
is there anything that you'd be more interested in exploring or changing in this? In
yeah. Project? Why are we going to argue? It's fine.
Well,
no, it's.
I don't want to be too harsh on you because you know, like I've got a lot sensitive. To say about this game, and you know, its lack of. So the controller's broken.
I can answer your question.
Okay, so how do I get to the Wisp things?
You have to look for some kind of. I think if you get above the clouds, you might see some. Little sparkly things going downwards.
Oh, how do I do that?
Turn right. Go and then kind of forwards and right. And up there somewhere.
So the island's procedurally generated?
Yes.
Was that an attempt to cash in on the Minecraft craze?
Yes.
I didn't see your face. Was that a look of panicked honesty or was that just polite laughter?
Yeah,
this is sweet. Where are the...
So there might be some little things.
Is it there? Or where?
Like sparkly things.
So when did the Wisps come in? At what point did you decide that it was... At what point did it, like, move from, like, a tech demo to, like, kind of... to like four movements and like a changing of seasons with like a sense of progression. Like, was that early? Yeah. Was it early on that you decided?
Fairly early, yeah. So I guess we had this. So you just had this world that you could walk around in, and you had the soundtrack that was generated based on where you were. Keep going right to right over that way. That way.
If it was better designed.
Oh, he's spent ages on that. That's one of the things he spent.
Maybe I wouldn't need the developer saying, oh, you just got to. I just got over there. Oh, no, you press A to crouch.
Yeah, it's all about, you know, discovering things for yourself.
Is that a dig at me?
Yes.
Are you saying I'm incapable of genuine discovery?
Modern gamers needing handholding.
Is Proteus really a satire? Is it like a satire on these sorts of games itself? Because it's very pretentious.
It is deliberately provocative, I guess, that a lot of people.
I thought it was. It kind of feels like very mild soap. I don't know if I'd call it provocative. It's changing. Yeah, what does this represent?
It's all about the change.
Does this rep? I bet you were so fucking pleased with yourself when you were like, oh, I can turn the time scale up and it'll be like days passing. But I see you didn't put quite enough energy to have it seamlessly transition. And you decided.
That was too much effort to kind of gradually like.
Yeah. I just realized that we're playing yours first, and that there's way more like lazy shit to call me on instantly. 5 minutes. Okay.
Oh yeah. So I guess provocative in the sense that people start playing it, and
did you get a lot of like, it's not a game?
Yeah, I'm the original. I started the culture wars. No, I don't know.
Did you start?
It's not quite true. It wasn't my fault. Provocative in the sense that it doesn't tell you what to do, and there's like a period of like discomfort at the beginning that's kind of fun. Like nothing's threatening you, but it's kind of uncomfortable.
Did you find that a lot of people wouldn't push past that level, that initial level of discomfort? Or?
Yeah, I think so. I think also that there's a really funny effect as well, where people have really enjoyed it and had a good time with it, but not gone past the first season and just kind of wandered around there and played it for like 45 minutes or an hour and switched it off and said, oh, I love it so much. And I'm like, oh, did you like the bit when this happened? Like, no, what? So there's a big balancing thing of trying to make that.
We're at the bees.
Yeah, find the nest. Let's try and steal the honey.
Can you steal the honey?
You can try.
I'll try. I'll do my best.
Yeah, they're in there somewhere. In one of those trees. Yeah.
Oh, shit. I think
get more bees.
Where can I get more bees?
Oh, bee combo.
There should be a big overlay on the screen like bee combo multiplier. And a little animated gif of your face that pops up.
I'm just racking my brains for some kind of bee based.
Have you seen Andy Sum's 420 Blaze It in the game? It's like I'd love to see that combined with like something like Proteus, where it's like starts off really gentle and it just gets more and more obnoxious, and there's never a clear turning point.
Like the parable of the frog in the pan of water, and the kind of heat is gradually turned up until it boils and it doesn't jump
memes
out.
Are added, but without the player noticing.
What else did you find?
So what are these? Are these like gravestones or?
Yeah, that's a little graveyard. And in autumn, this has got some slightly different stuff around it. So.
So there's how many like what are some of the areas on the island? Like there's the graveyard, there's the big tree.
Yeah.
There's like the mountain.
Yeah, the weird statues in the mountain. If it gets nighttime and if you find the statues, can.
Oh, I don't think I've done that. This is a mesh and everything else is billboards.
Yeah, I made that earlier, before the gravestones. The gravestones, I tried to make them much more consistent with the trees. But yeah, those stones, for some reason, I never actually took the mesh out and made it out of sprites.
I remember the first time I met you and I was really awkward and embarrassed because I was a big fan. And look at us now. Me taking the piss out of your grass billboards in front of a few hundred people.
Yeah, you've got well above your station.
Well, we'll see where we go in the second half. What happens if you just wander out into the ocean?
You just carry on going. Wow. There's nothing else. There was like fanciful thing I was going to do at one point was to put silhouettes of other islands, like generated silhouettes of other generated islands, and have it like transition over. But mm-hmm. it was just
too many people thought
scope.
That. Too many people too thought the work. Game was cooler than it was.
And there was at one point there was a teleport from. If you went like beyond a certain radius of the island, it like the eyes closed, and you kind of woke up back on the island, kind of like the prisoner with Patrick McGinn.
I like how you do water. I think this is the best water that I've seen in a game.
Thanks.
I think it's probably my favorite water. Wow. Do you do any like color correction, or is it all just hard values?
Each season has 8 palettes for different times in the day, and it interpolates through this.
Oh, really?
Through whole palettes, and there's a bitmap where you can open it up and like directly edit the palettes, which I think you need to do.
I've seen people have been modding this. There's like a modding scene for this. Like,
yeah, I occasionally, when I'm being kind of responsive and responsible, pay attention to that stuff. But yeah,
I know I framed that very well.
Good.
You're
good, mise en scène.
Sweet. How do we? Oh. No text, AN.
Yeah, look at this. It's ruined. Ruined the magic.
How do I quit? Yes. Oh, and the eye close. That's good. That's clever. Yeah. Proteus. Shall we swap?
Yeah.
It is really hard to play.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to the challenge of cricking my neck. Isn't that a screenshot of the beginner's guide?
That's not the beginner's guide. Thank you for starting us off on a great foot. I didn't make the beginner's guide, despite what nearly everybody seems to think.
I should pace myself.
Right, here we go. Here we go.
Stanley Parable.
Here we go.
The play button, it's being clicked.
Oh, I hope it doesn't crash.
Running.
No, that's Windows Media Player.
Something's going on at the bottom.
I just want to say, like, this is Steam. My responsibility starts after the game opens, so this isn't me.
Hey, it's good news.
You've got to prepare for it as well. You need to prepare. Come on!
I know.
Oh, you got a solid 20 minutes. Okay, does anybody have any questions while we figure this out?
We could play the Temple of No, you could put that on.
Oh, really? Does this have internet connection? I don't think this has internet connection. So raise your hand if you've got a question about Proteus or the Stanley Parable, and we can, anything. Yes!
I might set up to answer them.
Having started Contra War, does it, like, weigh on your soul? Can you sleep at night? Yeah.
So how do we sleep at night having started the culture war? I think I sleep quite easily because all the royalty payments from the Stanley Parable have enabled me to buy quite soft pillows and sheets. How do you sleep at night, Ed? Don't uninstall it.
Get rid of it.
Browse local game files. Browse local game files. You can open it from the. You can open it out of the. You can open it with the exe. Just browse local files.
Uh oh.
Okay. All right. So the game opens with a with a picture of a computer, and it reoccurs. The image reoccurs down the computer, and it's like if you hold up a camera to a screen, and it's about that's a message about the cyclical nature of life. And then you can press begin the game, and then a loading screen pops up, and at the bottom it says, "The end is never the end. Is never the end. Is never the end."
So that's definitely a step up from just creating dot dot dot. So
yeah, yeah, yeah. We put meaning into our menus.
Jeez.
Yeah, and so you start the game, and the narrator says, "This is the story of a man named Stanley." Oh, fuck, I've forgotten the rest.
And then he gets up from the chair. Yeah, he Stanley, works at desk 421.
Stanley works at 427. Stanley works in a company, and he's employee number 427, and all of his co-workers have disappeared. And so he gets up from his desk at one point, and he sees that nobody's there, and then he starts a story about... and. Look, it plays a lot better with visuals.
Can we
play Proteus again? Can we?
No, I want to ask you questions.
Because we can leave Proteus behind you. Like, we just have no internet, so we have whatever's local to this device. It's not my device.
Okay. Let's look at the third-party legal notices, yeah.
What else do you have on Steam? Is anyone on the... We've got Team Fortress 2. What else do we have? Is there anything else? Proteus, Kentucky Route Zero.
Yeah, Kentucky Route Zero.
Is there anything that you've, like, influenced?
I made Binding of Isaac Rebirth. I can talk about that. Like, legitimately, if you just click on that. Like, I was the designer of the Binding of Isaac Rebirth, and it's really a good coincidence that that's on here, because I can put it on! Put it on! I don't know who has it, but don't, yeah.
I could ask you questions about the Stanley Parable.
This is
our argument.
Ask me about the Stanley Parable. Put it on! It's preparing the launch. Okay, so what questions do you have about the Stanley Parable?
Don't
you dare fucking ask. Why doesn't it work,
Yeah. What does error OXC00001T mean?
It means that the computer wasn't tested beforehand.
Big burn. actor's tantrum now.
It's not an actor's tantrum. It's an actor's genuine level of anxiety about... Okay,
maybe you shouldn't have released the game.
So I created this under a pseudonym called Edmund McMillan, and I wrote it about my relationship with my mother. So play anything. Just go for it.
Oh, I've got to play.
Yeah, go for it. Okay, so it's a game about... that's actually a feature. I had a lot of issues with epilepsy when I was a child.
Yeah, I mean, if you leave
so
that on,
I decided
kind
to
of...
put that in the game just to make it that extra. It makes it raw, you know? Having something that could potentially kill me in my own game, I like to think that really means that I'm risking something when I'm bringing it to people. Can you play the game?
So you
click new run, and then you pick the character, and you can only pick Isaac at the start, because I played a lot of Super Mario Brothers, and in that game you can only play Mario.
Yeah.
So I self-insert quite a bit. There's a lot to deconstruct here. About what I kind of intended when I made the game, but
a lot of Freudian.
Yeah, so I've got a lot of issues around babies. my mum was gonna have a younger brother, and it was born, but my brother did die quite early on in my life, and so I made this game to kind of deal with that sadness. And have you played this before, Ed?
Not from this angle.
This is This is okay. So it's about. It's a lot about. Well, ask me a question about it. I'm not here to monologue. It's a back and forth. Help, please. Help! I have nothing prepared for this.
In.
I have two choices.
Okay, all right, okay. This is a story about a boy named Isaac. When he came to two doors, he entered the door on his south. Confronted with various enemies, he used the... Oh, fuck, how buggy is this? It's like the enemies are different sizes, they've not been scaled up properly, there's different pixel sizes, it's not on a straight pixel grid. What the... Ed, stop dying. Stop dying. I also added the flicker because I it's a callback to the menu screen. And so you collect the bomb and now you use the bomb.
I don't know.
Use the bomb. No, you're going to get trapped.
What's the button for bomb? I look, I'm fine. What?
You died.
All right.
Okay. Don't go sa- Oh, and you didn't even pick up the item? That means you lost half a heart for nothing. Now you've activated the flashing screen. Right. I like to add items that you just can't get to represent the love and affection I'll never receive from my parents.
I've met your parents, they're lovely.
Can you please? I know my parents aren't gonna watch this talk. I'll tell them. I was gonna play the stuff. It didn't work. So you gotta kill it. Okay, get the bomb.
All right.
Go down. Okay.
How do I use
it? Tell them. Don't run into the. Okay, if you stand in the corner, that means that they're gonna. Find it much easier to get you. Okay, so now you've got to. Does anyone have any questions?
What do you think
to
this
save
has in...
this? We've got 10 minutes. We've got 10 minutes, so you know, if you want, if there's anything. Ed, ask me some.
I know, but he's typically talking bollocks and making me play the.
I'll play it. Alright.
In the Stanley Parable.
Yeah.
What's going on? Can you not play this game?
What? I can't play this. Okay, watch this. Oh, fuck.
All right, speedrun. In the Stanley Parable, imagining this is the Stanley Parable.
Yeah.
Like, what... To what extent is that a game between you, the authors, and the player? I mean, like, how much is it a sort of... It's almost like a pre-canned conversation in the form of a...
That's... Okay.
But go on.
20 points to Ed for actually prepare. That's an actually good question.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. So I think games, yeah, I think viewing them as a conversation between players and the authors is interesting because I think it creates a sense of kind of play with another person, and it's not like an interesting pitch that I had way back before Crows for the next game was that we'd have an actual live server, and what we'd do is we'd have someone hired or one of the creators behind the server with a bunch of server console commands for like moving, opening doors, moving things around, playing audio clips. And maybe having a voiceover thing, and we'd charge tickets for that experience, for a single experience, and you could and it would be like wide ranging, and you'd get like maybe 20 minutes of that, and I don't know how much you'd pay, but like it would be a live experience, and
so like peak time on Steam when I don't know how many people are playing this game and whatever it would be, but like that person has access to control everyone's world.
Yeah, like I think with the Stanley Parable having pre-recorded kind of conversations and like the branching stuff, that's as close as you can get to kind of to playing with the player. But I think the nice thing about humans is they interpret so much, and they do so much of your job for you.
Yeah.
Like you don't need to put that much effort into making the game. Like So one of the choices we did early on was we stopped the game kicking you back to the menu screen, and we started the game. We started the game launching the game again from the, so you'd start in the office again rather than being bounced back to like a start the game menu, and that made everything feel a lot more cyclical and
interconnected. Yeah,
and then you add like one or two callbacks, like if you played the adventure line ending, when you play the game again, you'll see the adventure line kind of winding through the background again, and it kind of blends. It does a bit. I feel like we could have done more, but it does a bit to kind of blend the separation between endings, and it stops people from seeing it as a selection of choices and a branching narrative, and starting to see it as like a process of discovery, which I think is cool.
I think also the great thing about that, and also, I'm not going to try and say the entire name of the game, but Dr. Langerskov and the terribly cursed emerald and the tiger and the world in heist and the other things.
Yeah.
That has a similar sense of like inviting mischievous behavior from the player. Like the Stanley Parable, the classic one is the two doors at the beginning, but then there's also the broom cupboard. You can go into there and just stay in there forever. And the narrator kind of gets more and more irate that you're wasting time in the game. Mm. But once you know that the game is responding to that kind of stuff, it sort of gives you this brilliant kind of permission to try strange things.
I think there's something I really like about the game taking itself seriously, because I see it as like you're interacting with a teacher.
Yeah.
And I think that's definitely similar for maybe not the Temple of No or accounting, but for Langerskov and Stanley, there's very much a feeling that the game wants you to have a very specific type of experience. Mm-hmm. And if you misbehave, it's just we take into account that, and it allows like players to really lean into the kind of disobedient kid thing. For most of school I was very good and polite, and it was only towards the end that I learned the joys of taking the piss. And I think maybe part of what I enjoy about it is it's like a childhood kind of permission to make fart sounds in the classroom and to have like a comic book behind your dictionary or whatever. But like I like very much the game insisting that it's kind of the authority figure in this interaction, when in reality it's absolutely the opposite. It's the game needs to perform a function for the player, and the player needs to enjoy themselves. So like in reality it's the opposite way around, but I like the pretense of a character being like, I'm in charge, welcome to this game, and you're gonna if you listen to what I'm telling you, we're gonna have a great time. Yes. And you're gonna really appreciate this, you know.
It's also an interesting contrast with the physical, pseudo-physical limitation of the game itself, because like in both Proteus and Stanley, walking simulators, you can only walk around. There's like really, I mean, and true for any game, like there are only like a certain number of things you can do, and it's extremely constrained and restrictive. But then you're kind of, I guess, lampshading that, to use the kind of TV tropes name for giving the player this very strict space to play in. Mm-hmm. But then you pretend there's another level of strictness on top of that.
Yeah, it's fun. It's like I think with the kind of design of the world that kind of mirrors that is you've got various layers of what's considered the behind the scenes or the look behind the scenes. Like my favorite moment in any game ever, I think, is Portal, where you move outside of what you thought was the constraint of the entire game. Mm. And like I really appreciated the hidden and how most of their marketing material, you only saw the chambers of Portal, and the kind of traditional like puzzle element. And you thought going in, okay, maybe there'll be like a bit of story, or maybe there'll be some audio tapes or whatever, you know. But it's primarily a puzzle game with like that's mechanics based. But for me, Portal's incredibly story based, and my favorite moment is when you push past the kind of what you thought was going to be the hard limit of the game. And I guess Stanley's is just that repeated as many times as we could get away with.
Right, right.
Like transcending different boundaries. You transcend the boundary of the game restarting in the confusion ending. You transcend the boundary of the narrator being present in various endings. You transcend the physical limitation of the office space to like either either like warehouses or dev textured bare rooms or a big mind control facility, an underground hidden lair, and then you keep transcending these layers. But then the fun part is when people realize that no, you are still trapped within the kind of hard limit of the game.
And it's just the
2 minutes.
The great thing in Langeskov, there's extending that theme further. Langeskov, so Dr. Langeskov starts with you're kind of promised a certain game experience, mm-hmm. like you're promised that you're going to be taking part in this heist and you're going to be attacked by a tiger and things, but then you're immediately behind the scenes and it's hinted that all this stuff is happening. Oh, that's it. Yeah, so another player is playing the game and any one person can play it once.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Dr. Langeskov, the Tiger and the Terribly Cursed Emerald, the Whirlwind Heist, is a free game that my studio Crows 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 released just over a year ago. And in it, you enter the game and all the marketing material tells you to expect like a heist game where you've got to, deactivate lasers, jump through vents, you know, hide from guards. And when you get in there, you are confronted by a stage manager type character, and the character says, okay, I'm sorry, like only one person can play this game at a time, and someone's already playing it. We don't know how two of you got in here at once. So you have to move through the behind-the-scenes space, never seeing the true game. And I think, yeah, that's a fun inversion of like the, oh, I'm in the set, and I want to see behind the scenes, and you know, all of that.
Is it okay to wrap up there?
No, that's perfectly fine.
What are your takeaway moral or message from the whole experience, should you have one?
I don't know. How we make very different games, but I feel like a lot of it comes from the same place of providing an experience. Providing an experience for a player, but that's what all games do. I don't know. What's the take? What's the take, Ned? What's the take?
I can
help,
take you away.
Help me. Help.
I mean, they're both kind of about subversion in different ways, subverting expectations and using game tools and providing a different sort of space to play within, I suppose. Mm. Like tying back into the first talk this morning about creating, different ways that interactivity can work and different like ways that you can present a space where you can explore it in ways other than mastering a system or getting to a goal.
It feels like there's a real pleasant mischievousness about both of your, like, I guess not just those particular games, but your body of work in general, which are like enjoying leaving room for the player to discover in that, like, because famously there's like two Greek words for two different kinds of play. There's paida and there's ludus or ludum, or I didn't remember that one properly. And one is rule-based, one is strictures, and it's about the fun that arises from a rule set. And then there's paida, which is like playground play. It's like running around and going, I'm this now, ha, and that beats that. And I feel like there is a pleasant amount of paida in your kind of approach to making games, which engages with that feeling of wonder and discovery and invention. So that it feels surprising in the same way as I feel like when I watch a really good jazz improviser doing something like I couldn't even imagine was possible. And that's how I feel like when it...
Hey! So...
And on that note, I feel like nothing really could surpass that as a conclusion. So let's just do a great big round of applause for Ed Key and William Pugh. And if you want to come back, we're having a short break now, but if you come back at 3, we have two sessions, one from Lila Xavier, which is called Standalone.